Wow, if you weren't here last night, something marvelous took place last night. For those of you who do not know this, we leveled this floor in half. It was a 7% grade. We took out two of the steps and they poured concrete in here that we could use this as a multi-purpose building. And if you see all the tables, we had 30 tables set up in here last night for a wonderful family Christmas. And it was so great to see, boy, I don't know, we had close to 200 people, I think, seated in here. And it was such a great time. And some of the family brought decorations. That's why you see only this much of the tree decorated, because this is about how tall the people are in our church. So we're going to try to do stuff this week. And one other reminder, which is a great problem to have, every year we do a Christmas kind of an offering. And we've had some services here where we had to turn people away because we don't have enough chairs. And that's a good problem to have. But we don't want that to happen. So we're going to try to purchase 75 more chairs that we're going to try to squeeze in here before we go to a third service. So if you're willing to do that, we have a chest up here that is going to our remodel, our Joash project to remodel God's temple. And so if you can help out with that, if you want to give a gift to Jesus that's represented here. So God bless you and thank you all for being here today. If you take your outlines out with me today, we are starting a brand new season for the holidays, and it's entitled The Reason for the Season. And this morning we're talking about King Herod and how he missed the miracle of Jesus. Well, what is the reason for this season? And I would ask to you, why is there so much disconnect in the world about Christmas? Now, how many of you know, even I think this year, but for the last couple of years, there has been a move in our retail industry during the Christmas season that no longer are the employees allowed to say Merry Christmas, but they are to say Happy Holidays. Isn't that interesting? How they want to take Christ out of Christmas. It's like February 14th, we don't say Happy Holidays. What do we say? Happy Valentine's Day. During Thanksgiving, we don't say Happy Holidays. We say Happy Thanksgiving. And the world is even trying to turn that to have a Happy Turkey Day. But there is a disconnect between what the true meaning and reason of Christmas is about. And we can see that our society, the world today, wants to remove Christ from our society. And if you can believe this, they want to move Christ out of Christmas. Even on some of the calendars, instead of Christmas, it says what?
Xmas.
Taking the Christ out of Christmas. Why are people so uncomfortable about putting Christ in Christmas? Well, the world doesn't want to have to come face to face with Christ. That's really the true reason. Because when you and I are faced with coming face to face with Christ, you know what happens? Something has to change. There is change that needs to take place. We know that when we come face to face with Him, something different will happen in our lives. Our lives don't remain the same. And when we resist change, we don't know that we miss the miracle that God has for each and every one of us. Well, King Herod had a dilemma in a place where he had the ability to come face to face with Jesus. Now, if you look at the first verse in your outline, it's found in Matthew chapter 2, and we're going to look at several verses from Matthew chapter 2, and it says this: In the days of Herod the king, Magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem, saying, Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star in the east, and we have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was what? Trouble and all of Jerusalem with him. Well, why was King Herod troubled? Well, let me give you a little background about King Herod. King Herod, who was the king of the Jews, was not really a Jew. He was an Edomite. When Isaac had two sons, Esau and Jacob, Jacob was the chosen one. God changed his name to Israel. And Esau was, and his descendants were called Edomites. And so we see that Herod had the position of being king of the Jews, and he was really not a Jew. So we see, as the historians trace his background, it's very interesting to see what took place in his life. His father, who was king, did some things wrong as he went against the political system in the Roman government, and historians tell us that King Herod's father was put to death right in front of him. We see that King Herod was so holding on to his position as king, he killed his wife, he killed a lot of his sons, and anybody who threatened his position as the king. Sounds like a nice guy, huh? And all those close to him put to death. That way you keep people far from his kingdom. So we see here that as he was appointed by the Roman government as the position of king of the Jews, imagine all of his insecurities that were dwelling within inside of him. He didn't want anything to come into the way and to threaten his kingdom. In our society today, we see a struggle of having anything to do with Christ in our society. There's a separation of trying to get Christ out of anything to do with our government and our business. We don't want any moral or ethical accountability. And any attempt at placing Christ back into our government system, we see that there is a fight. And so we see in Herod's example, there are three lessons that I want to talk to you about what happens when Christ shows up in our midst. We see that Christmas time is a time that we celebrate Emmanuel, which means God with us. God wrapped himself in flesh and came to dwell and to be with us and to ultimately give up his life for us. When Christ shows up, would you write this down? Number one, there can only be one king. There can only be one king. When you look at the life of Herod and the position he held of power and position and control, in his life, we see that he wanted control of his life. In fact, control was his king. He wanted to control his own kingdom. He wanted to control his own life. Does that sound familiar? Because there's a little wrestle in us a lot of times, isn't there? We have a little King Herod, if you will, in our lives. Right? That we want to control things. A lot of times we don't trust Jesus with sitting on the throne of our lives. So a lot of times come on, be real with me, guys. There's times when Jesus Christ is on the throne of our lives and we're spiritual, we're feeling good, and we're following Jesus. And then isn't there times we want to take Jesus off the throne and come on, we put ourselves up there? Come on, don't give me that glazed over look. You know what I'm talking about. Don't act like you're all spiritual and stuff all the time. I'm not even there. Hey, we need Jesus. And there is a battle that the enemy wants to constantly put self on the throne. And it really has to do with trust. Do we trust Jesus? Do we trust his promises? Can we wait and not have immediate gratification and control like we see that King Herod wanted? A lot of times you and I have a big problem in waiting for the Lord to show up. Come on. Some people wait for a spouse and they wait and they wait and they wait. Some people get tired of waiting. And usually God waits to the very last minute to show us something that it is God working in our lives and it's not us making those things happen. And that's what's so difficult. A lot of times we control things and we try to make it happen and we come to the end of ourselves and find out how weak we are. When we come face to face, when the Lord shows up, we're faced with the dilemma that we are not God. That is the Lord who wants to be the king of our lives. There was something I saw on Dateline a few years ago where they took these kids, probably about 6, 7 years old, and put them in a room. And they said, we're going to give you a marshmallow. You can eat it now, but if you wait, you will get 2 marshmallows. And it was amazing to watch. Any of you see that on TV? The pain of these kids. The pain in their face of trying not to eat that marshmallow. And I love it. This one, I used an illustration where they take the marshmallow, and this one, they didn't eat it, but they smell it. One didn't eat it, but he licked it. Come on, isn't that like us? Don't eat of it. I'm not going to eat it. I just want to smell it. Don't eat of it. I'm not going to eat it. I just want to touch it. Don't eat of it. I'm not going to eat it. I just want to taste it. Come on. And those ones who passed the test and they gave 2 marshmallows. We see a lot of times we're like King Herod. We don't want to wait for God's control in life. We want it now. We want immediate resolution of struggles that we go through. We want God to intervene and we want Him to do it now. We don't want to be in pain. We don't want to rustle through. We don't want to do the pain things of trusting in God despite how circumstances look. God is at work. If you have the hope of Christ in your heart, God is already at work. Begin to thank Him and praise Him because the answer, God's already working. That's the faith, that's the strength that we know. And we wait for the reward or the promises that God has for us. Sometimes we give in to our anger, unforgiveness, to our lusts. And we want immediate resolution now. And when we give in to sin, we allow sin to take control of our lives. And we have a tendency to be just like King Herod. We want to take control of our lives, not allowing God to be the one in control. Look what it says here in Philippians 2, 9 through 11. It says, for this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess, what? That Jesus Christ is Lord. Every knee will bow. Listen, every single knee from every person, from every point in history will bow at Jesus Christ. Isn't it great to have the freedom and to freely do it now? Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ came to this earth as a child to ultimately die on the cross for all our sins. Any sinners in the house? Okay, the rest of you see me after church, you're a liar. You are a sinner. Gosh, I get you every time. Colossians 3, 1 through 5, it says this, since then you have been raised with Christ. Set your minds on things where? Not on earthly things. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with Him in glory. Put to death, therefore, what belongs to your earthly nature. See, there is a constant battle of the spirit and the flesh. And so the Bible says that we are to keep our eyes focused not on the earthly things, not on the things like King Herod did, because King Herod focused upon his kingdom. He focused on what he could accomplish. He focused on all the possessions. He focused on his power and positions and his career and all those things in life. And if you and I are careful, we can have those earthly eyes and we focus upon our kingdom. We never say it like that, but it is true. We focus on what we can get in this life on earth. But he says, don't keep your eyes focused on things below. Keep them focused on the things above. You will have a greater life even here on earth. There is something about joy and trust and hope. Something that God works in us even in very devastating circumstances. Because we can go through those times and God's presence is there with us. His joy and His peace surrounds us. When you come face to face with Jesus Christ, something has to change. And during this Christmas season, maybe you can reflect on your life. What are things in your life during this Christmas season that you need to surrender to the Lord? What are things in your life that you are putting yourself first and building on your kingdom, that you would take all those things and you would lay it down? There can only be one king. Number two, if you'd write this down, pursue him yourself. Pursue him yourself. It was not King Herod's intent to find Jesus face to face. Look what it says in this verse here, found in Matthew chapter 2, 4 through 8. Now gathering together all the chief priests and the scribes, he, meaning King Herod, inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. Then Herod secretly called the Magi, and he sent them to Bethlehem, and he said, "Go and search carefully for the child, and when you have found him, report to me so that I too may come and worship him." Isn't that amazing? Was he telling the truth?
No.
Come on, if he really wanted to find Jesus face to face, he wouldn't have sent strangers, these Magi, these wise men, to go find him. Come on, when we had 9/11 and we wanted to go find Osama bin Laden, who did we send? Anybody know? Soldiers, right? How about when we wanted to find Saddam Hussein, who did we send? Soldiers. Come on, if King Herod really wanted to find Jesus, he probably would have sent his soldiers. Go find him. And they would have went in and tore things apart to find Jesus. And then they would have sent word and he would have met Jesus face to face. I wonder what would happen if King Herod met Jesus face to face. Come on, do you know something happens? Folks, do you know something happens to our heart when you and I meet Jesus face to face? I've seen people in prison. Hard hearts. People who have killed other people. And I've seen grown men have such a change of heart when they have seen Jesus face to face. I wonder what would happen. See, that's why you and I need to pursue the Lord for ourselves. Sometimes we have godly grandmothers, godly parents, and we say, you know what, yeah, my parents went to church, my parents loved the Lord. No, it's not about them. When you stand before the Lord, it's you. It's me. It's our relationship, what we invested. How soft our heart was before God, that we fulfilled the purpose that God called us to do and to be, and to be great men and women of faith, trusting God. See, what you go through, folks, what struggles you go through, you are telling a great story of bringing glory to God through your lives. That's why we are called to look at things above, not look at earthly things, even when we struggle. What a contrast we see between the shepherds in Luke chapter 2 and the wise men. These wise men see a star in the distance, probably coming from the Babylonian Empire, and as they are coming, these are, listen, men of great stature. These wise men, they had great wealth, great stature in their kingdom, because they were able to come in and they meet with who? The king. See, they were kind of like kings in their own right, but what did they do? They came with all their wealth, all their gold and all their stuff, and they bowed down and they literally gave to Jesus Christ out of what? Worship. The shepherds came. They left their flocks, which was a big thing. They left their flocks and they came. Why? Because they wanted to come with Jesus face to face. And hey, when you and I come with Jesus, when we come to him face to face, there's something that happens to us. Our heart gets soft and we want to worship God because he is the Lord. He is the King of Kings. You need to pursue the Lord for yourself. Yesterday, my wife and I, we were sitting down. We woke up early and we put a fire in the fireplace and we got our Bibles out. We are doing a Bible study together, and there was just something happened. It was so special. Tears were coming down from my eyes, and Diane was reading something. Tears were coming out of her eyes, and it was just something wonderful that the Lord spoke to us through His Word that so touched our hearts, the living Word that so touches us. You and I are called to pursue the Lord. I'm glad that you're here at church today. It is a step in the right direction that you're stepping out and saying, I depend upon the Lord. And I encourage you to keep coming to church, to encourage one another, to pray for one another, and get encouraged yourself. But you and I are called to pursue the Lord daily. Give us this day our weekly bread. Come on, how many of you eat weekly? Don't lie to me, I see you. Come on. Come on, we are to eat daily, taking the Lord to sustain us. But we want to live in this life, and we want our kingdoms to sustain us. We want our position to sustain us. We want power, we want possessions, we want all these things to sustain us. But they fall way short. That's why we need to pursue the Lord for ourselves, each of us. And then number three, allow Him to grow up. Allow Him to grow up. See, we see that the greatest threat to Herod was not when Jesus was a baby, but when He grew up, what would happen? Look what it says here in Matthew 2:16. It says, then when Herod saw that he had been tricked by the Magi, he became very enraged. Underline that word, enraged. See, there's people in our society that get enraged with Christ at Christmas. There are people who get enraged when they see a manger scene in a city square. There are people that get enraged when they see crosses in our society today. And we see in this text that he became very enraged. And listen how enraged he became. And he slew all the male children who were in Bethlehem and all its vicinity from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had determined from the Magi. See, the Magi probably told them that they saw the star there for a while, because it's believed they came from the Babylonian Empire, that they traveled literally thousands of miles. Can you believe that back then? They traveled such a far distance to see Jesus. You know what's so amazing? When King Herod asked the religious leaders, the scribes and the Pharisees, where was the Messiah to be born? You know what they said? 5 miles away over in Bethlehem. Think about the wise men who traveled thousands of miles to be there, where the religious leaders were 5 miles away. Being so close religiously, but so far away that they couldn't go that distance to see Jesus. And yet we see the heart of these wise men who traveled and did whatever it took to see Jesus face to face. Isn't that an awesome story? Yet we see King Herod so enraged. So enraged at Jesus that he didn't want Jesus to grow up in his life. There are people who are afraid that Jesus might grow up in their life. Sometimes our lifestyles and the excuses we make don't change. We don't allow Christ to grow in our hearts. Look what it says here in Hebrews 6:1. Therefore, leaving the elementary teaching about Christ, let us press on to, say it with me, maturity, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God. See, you and I need to press on towards maturity. There are some people who have been in the faith a long time, but their maturity level is still small. Yet I've seen young children who had a great maturity level, even being young. We have many examples of that in the Bible. But here, learn what God wants you to learn. Love the unlovable. Serve others. Get involved. Don't just be hearers of the word, but be doers of the word. Through all these things, we need to meet Christ face to face. In conclusion, I want to tell you a story. It was a young boy who was going to have heart surgery. And he meets with the surgeon, and the surgeon is explaining what's going to happen in this open heart surgery. And the little boy said to the surgeon, "When you open up my heart, you're going to find Jesus in my heart." The boy was relentless in saying this. He was beaming with joy, but the surgeon was annoyed. And when the surgeon was alone, he had his recorder on. And what happened when he opened the boy's heart? He recorded the details. He looked up above and he spoke to God. He says, "God, why did you do this to him?" He said, "A short time, he's going to be dead. Why?" And as tears was running down this doctor's face, he came face to face with God. God, our Creator, touched the surgeon's heart. And when he went back to visit the boy after the surgery, the boy asked him, "Did you cut open my heart? What did you find? Did you see Jesus in my heart?" He answered, "Yes, I did." Talk about maturity. The boy, this young boy, came face to face with Jesus. Whatever happened to him, he knows what's going to happen because Jesus is in his heart. This season, we should discover this one great lesson. If you'd write this down, the greatest miracle is in you. The greatest miracle is in you as you ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart and life, to be not only your Lord and your Savior, but your King. That means that you allow Jesus to be on the very throne of your heart to guide you, to direct you, that you submit to Christ in your life. Christ in us, the Bible says, is the hope of glory. The greatest gift that God gives to us is Himself, Jesus Christ. And like every good gift, what must we do? I hand you a gift, what do you have to do?
Receive
it. And so the greatest challenge is that you and I would come face to face with God and we would receive Him. And all that means, that we submit ourselves and really, we, like the wise men, we lay ourselves down before Him. And we bow our hearts before Him and we say, "O King, be King of my life. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for coming to this earth. Thank you for dying on the cross for all of my sins." There is a verse on your outline. It's found in 1 Corinthians 11:28. And it's in regards to receiving communion, which we're going to do in a few moments here. But it says, "But a man must examine himself, and in so doing, he is to eat of the bread and drink of the cup." What he's saying here is when we receive communion, it's something that shouldn't be done lightly. But the Bible says that we should examine our very hearts to make sure as we come before the Lord that we're doing it with the right heart. Because it is very important. It symbolizes what Christ has done for us. That He gave of His life, being nailed upon the cross, His blood was shed, that we might have the forgiveness of our sins. And we're all in need of a Savior, and we're all in need of forgiveness, right? And so it's very symbolic. The Bible says, as often as you do this in remembrance of what I've done for you. But before we receive communion, I'm going to give you an opportunity just to receive Christ. The gift that is going forth today. Maybe you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord or your Savior. We're going to give you an opportunity, as we often do, that you would receive Christ maybe for the first time. You don't have to do it week after week. You just do it one time. And so would you bow your heads with me, and we're going to pray. And I'm going to ask everyone to repeat this prayer with me. Dear Jesus. Everyone, dear Jesus. Thank you for coming to this earth. Thank you for dying upon the cross for my sins. Lord, forgive me. my sins. Cleanse me, Lord, from all unrighteousness. And Lord, I receive you into my heart and into my life. As I come face to face with you, I receive you as my Savior and as my King. And I lay myself at your feet. And I say, Lord, guide and direct me all the days of my life. In Jesus' name. Would you keep your heads bowed and your eyes closed for one more moment? If you said that prayer for the first time and you really meant that prayer in your heart, we received Jesus today. Would you just raise your hand right back down? Keep your hands up for a moment. Okay. All right. Any others? Okay. See what happened. Lord, we thank you for your word today. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness to us even when we're not faithful. But Lord, it is your kindness that draws us to you. Lord, we love you. We thank you for all that communion means, that Lord, that you invite all of us to receive, those who believe you, those who love you, that Lord, by the bread we're reminded of your body that was broken, that we might have wholeness. For your, the cup that we received this morning symbolizes your blood that was shed for us. And Lord, as we receive communion today, may it be very symbolic of how we receive you into our hearts and into our lives. So Lord, we are so thankful for what you accomplished upon that cross at Calvary. And we thank you. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. It was good to be in the house of the Lord today. Amen. Amen.